So, welcome to the second part of this morning session. Our next speaker will be Kay Lisha, who is currently a faculty member at the Free University of Berlin and leading a research group in the field of nanomedicine, bioconjugation chemistry, and molecular imaging. For all his studies, he was at the University of Berlin, including for his PhD on the subject of olfactory compound. And then he worked at the Institute of Diagnosis Research at Berlin, and he pioneered the emerging field of fluorescence imaging and the design of optical imaging probes. And in a subsequent industrial position at Schering and Bayer Schering Pharma, he developed imaging probes toward clinical applications. And one of these compounds is tested in phase one trial for optical mammography. Then in 2008, he co-founded Mivenion GmbH, which is a life science company focusing on personalized medicine for patients with inflammatory and autoimmune diseases. And one of the compounds is developed to EU and US markets approval. And also, he developed in collaboration with Rainer Haag a novel nanomedicine on the basis of anti-inflammatory polymers. And finally, he said financing and establishing a pipeline in a compound against through after cancer and liver disease targets. And so he's both at the university and he has an entrepreneurial mindset. So it's to you.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. Thank you for this invitation, kind introduction. To the summary, what I did, almost forgot it by myself. So I would like to talk about multivalent nanosystems to target inflammation. This has always been the background of our research, both at the university and also in startup companies, to deal with primarily things around arthritis and osteoarthritis as inflammatory and autoimmune diseases. And at the university, I would like to talk about a polymer class, the so-called dendritic polyglycerols, and tell you a little bit what we do with this kind of compounds. So as we all know, has been addressed numerous times, is that polymers can mimic biological active macromolecules in a certain way. An interesting phenomenon is that especially globular proteins or three-dimensional assemblies can do this by also applying charge as the most simplest way of interaction. So, you know, we all know we talked about positive charge compounds used in the field of gene delivery as iRNA delivery, forming certain micelles and complexes on the one hand. Then on the other hand, the neutral basic compounds, which can be used when we talk about sugars and so on. And I would like to focus on the middle part, that we use polymers and make them highly anionic with anionic charge and groups on the surface. We'd like to see what's happening and how can we use these compounds in particular in the field of treating, but and also then targeting or imaging inflammatory diseases. So if we talk about these kind of polymers or dendrimers, particles, certain assemblies, we always have to keep in mind that those things can be made specific, and we'd like to address a certain protein-protein interaction, a certain molecular target on the one hand, but also on the other hand, then we have to deal with unspecific protein adsorption, and this is something which also contributes to the properties of such compounds. So if you like to, what we have seen here these days, have specific surface interaction by certain ligands, then we would like to go to a receptor, have receptor-mediated cellular uptake and intracellular delivery. This can happen, but on the other hand, it's clear that especially charged compounds, they attract proteins in a non-specific way. That means we have to deal with something which is then a certain protein corona. So what's happening on the surface, what is binding to the surface, and this might even much more determine the ADME, the pharmacokinetic properties, and also are certain barriers crossed, and then ultimately, how is the PK, the pharmacokinetics and the excretion, and also the stability and metabolism of these compounds. This is something, this is the field which has to be considered to really characterize such drugs or carrier systems. So what we do at Freie University is we, and this is the focus of this talk, we focus on the field of polyglycerol. These are compounds which consist of always a glycerol unit, three carbons and hydroxy groups, and they can be made in different kinds of ways towards macromolecular entities. That means what we can do is to have perfect dendrimers, hyperbranch architectures, and also then more sophisticated architecture, all based on the fact that we have a large number of hydroxy groups on the surface. These smaller entities are today already within cosmetics and in the food industry. So these are compounds which are quite inert and well tolerated when it comes to at least to its surface delivery. So and these compounds can then even be made into transferred into nanogels, microgels, and hydrogels by cross-linking them, and altogether they have a tendency to are extremely protein repellent. So they are very hydrophilic, very well soluble in water, and have a very low tendency to interact with proteins. We have a lot of projects in that field where we use these compounds to modify surfaces, for instance, to produce anti-fouling surfaces, to protect certain metal surfaces with respect to decomposition or assembly of proteins on the surface. But I would like to talk today about using such an architecture, so a dendritic, non-perfect polymer, as something which we can then use, transfer into something polyanionic, and see what's happening in terms of anti-inflammatory properties. So, and this is working like this. So what we do, so we come from actually something which is important to know in the field of cell-cell interaction in progression of inflammation. You know that when there's an inflammatory trigger, that leukocytes are attracted on the surface of endothelial cells and are attracted to the site of inflammation. And this is based primarily on such sugars, like here, for instance, thiolyl Lewis X, which you see is a very complex but highly specific entity based on certain hydroxy groups, based on certain connections of saccharide units, and also based on certain existence of sulfate groups. So some of these hydroxy groups are sulfated, and this leads to a highly specific interaction with selectines, which are responsible for cell-cell interaction. This receptor-ligand interactions are of highly specific, but they have a low affinity in the millimolar range, but it's important. And we thought, in the group some years back already, why not taking the polyglycerol with these many hydroxy groups here and make this thing very simple, truncate, simplify, and then multiply these sulfate groups here by just synthesizing such a compound where we can transform or transfer the hydroxy group OH to a sulfate by a sulfation reaction with sulfur trioxide, making OH to OSO3 minus, and then mostly as with sodium as a counter ion. And this is our, let's say, a working horse or compound, which we have been characterizing and applying. So this would look like this year, for example, to give you some more specific numbers, such a compound here, a dendritic polyglycerol sulfate. We abbreviate this like DBGS. Yeah. It is hyperbranched and has a PDI, which is not so good sometimes, a PEG, polyethylene glycol, often, but this is also commercially produced today, is better, but something like in the range of 1.3 to 1.8. And then sulfation with sulfur trioxide pyridine complex can be adapted in a way that you have a certain degree of sulfation on these hydroxy groups from zero or let's a few percent up to almost 100% of these hydroxy groups are sulfated. We have a compound now in the subsequent studies I will be showing, which has then a molecular weight roughly in the range of, let's say, 15 kD altogether. Yeah? This is our current molecular weight range to work with. Then, second, it is important, we would like to follow this compound, to trace it, to track it. We need to label it in a certain way. So what we did here is to establish a synthesis in a kilogram scale already, where we do this synthesis of the polyglycerol. So the dendritic polyglycerol is synthesized by an anionic living polymerization, ring opening polymerization reaction based on glycidol, this epoxide here. Yeah? And you can do this and grow this dendrimer. And with a copolymerization with something which has an amino group, like this compound here, we then come to something which is DPGS and has this fetal imido group at a certain percentage in the structure. And we were able then to sulfate the polymer and then to cleave this fetal imido group. You know, this is something you can cleave with hydrazine, but in this case, we used sodium borohydrate and then acetic acid. In this technical step here. And what we got is something which is called DPGS, molecular weight 12,000, PDI 1.5, sulfation degree above 85%, but 5% of these hydroxy groups then are amino groups. And this allows us then to do labeling, to connect something covalently to this compound, for instance, something which is radioactive, or also the drugs later on. You have seen a poster here of our group where we use this compound to deliver cytotoxic agents, but then also, and this is something I will be showing here, fluorescent dyes to do optical imaging and perform animal studies for the imaging of diseases. So, talking about this effect which we saw with this polysulfated compound, dendritic polyglycerol sulfate, this is something we showed, is able to inhibit leukocyte extravasation through, and now it's interesting, it's a nanomolar binding to L and P selectines. That means in the normal process of the onset of inflammation, where leukocytes are attracted by the cell-cell interactions, this compound, the DPGS, blocks these interactions and the inflammation is not able to progress and can be then fought and be treated. What we did is to translate this effect into a quantitative in vivo assay based on surface plasmon resonance, a Biocore assay, where gold nanoparticles are used with the selectins, LNP selectin on the surface. That is something we can synthesize. And then we have the binding partners, the normal binding partners, which is something like this, on the surface of a Biocore chip. And again, what you can do is then to put into the system our polymer or our dendrimer, DPGS, and then determine an IC50 value, how this DPGS is capable to inhibit the L-selectin binding, which is the underlying process in the inflammation process. So what we then obtained here is something quite special. In part, we don't understand why this is the case. So you have then here certain IC50 curves, typical, and then, but no need to look into detail here, but then the L-selectin inhibition looks like that. We synthesize not only polysulfates, we synthesized also polycarboxylates, polyphosphates, polyphosphonates, sulfonates, so not OSO3-, but just alkyl SO3-, and then the sulfates. And interestingly, so all anions you can imagine, I don't know others except then something which has no relevant pKa value in the physiological range. So we found out that we have micromolar capability to inhibit the L-selectin binding, goes down to something which close to nanomolar, but only the sulfate moiety with 8 nanomolar has a unique effect. So this polysulfate is able to inhibit L-selectin binding, but not the other polyanionic structures. And when we go into certain kind of SAR, structural activity relationship, which is not really an SAR, because we don't synthesize defined compounds, but at least what we can do is to look at the size of the polymer, and we found out also that inhibition increases with the size of the polyglycerol core, so the larger the compound, the lower the value, the better the inhibition on the one hand. And then, of course, then we can play with a degree of sulfation, because sometimes we don't want to have so many sulfate groups, the less the better. And we can see that if we inhibition increases with a degree of sulfation, or if you have not such a high density of sulfate groups, you lose your inhibition capacity, which is something in the range of 40% sulfate groups, and then you lose it. Yeah, so something we can do. We can use the hydroxy groups to sulfate them. Not all of them necessary. We need some to transform them into linkers and to conjugate other compounds to this entity. So, by telling this, this is a slide which shows a little bit more chemistry. We would like to follow the compounds in vivo for imaging, uptake into disease, but also then pharmacokinetics and stuff like that. What you can do here is quite some chemistry on these polyglycerols. For instance, to introduce radioactivity, we had a project where we truncated or we cleaved these 1,2 dihydroxy entities on the surface by sodium periodate and then with radioactive tritiumated sodium borohydrate. You can introduce tritium to this compound and then followed by the sulfation have a radioactive dendritic polyglycerol sulfate which has almost the original structure. Another thing is, but this is quite nasty because this is a beta emitter and it is expensive and really tricky to work with. What you can do is to sulfate with sulfur 35. To get a radioactive compound, and you have to then always keep in mind what is the entity you would like to follow. Here you have the core stably labeled on the one hand. Here you have the sulfate ester labeled, and you would follow sulfate, keeping in mind that this ester can be hydrolyzed in vivo and your radioactivity goes into sodium sulfate or sulfuric acid. I will show something about coming from this work here, where we coupled to an azide, which we have here by click chemistry and chelator, and used in collaboration with Dresden-Rossendorf in Germany, the ability to introduce PET and SPECT isotopes for imaging. And last but not least, and that is the focus today, is that at this point, we coupled fluorescent dyes to the polymer. On the one hand, a dye which is our own version, so we have a dye synthesis lab. We do our own fluorescent dyes, also responsive dyes, pH responsive dyes, reductively responsive dyes, and so on. And this is a size 3 dye, we call it ICC, in that range for fluorescent microscopy. And this is an indocyanine green dye, we call it 6SICG, our own synthesis, which is a dye in the near infrared to do optical imaging in animal models. So, and yeah, this summarizes again a little bit. So, we have quite a large portfolio of dyes for every purpose you like to have in terms of the wavelength, but also in terms of responsiveness. What I don't show here but can briefly mention is we have some diets which have a pH activatable, only light up when they are taken up into acidic compartments, which is important when we want to follow these compounds, whether or not they are taken up by endocytosis and end up in vesicles or endosomes with low pH. And this is something we can really nicely then follow with activatable dyes, only lighting up when this when the pH goes below 6 or something. So we did a study, or several studies, in rats with collagen-induced arthritis in the joints of the hind limbs of rats. So what we saw is that DPGS, with a labeled with a near-infrared dye, accumulates in collagen-induced joint inflammation. And we compared this here with a compound, which is this one, ETA-6-ICG. ETA is etanercept, and this is the market product, which is called Enbrel by the company Pfizer. This is the major product to treat rheumatoid arthritis today. It is a protein directed against TNF-alpha, which was years back identified as the major target to treat the autoimmune boost of rheumatoid arthritis. It was interesting to see how our compounds, how these polymers, also are taken up in these disease models. And what you can see here is that with this antibody ending up in inflamed joints, it's quite similar with our much smaller polymer. You could imagine, but this, yeah, is more or less the case, that even smaller inflammation sites are reached by these compounds in the joints of these animals. But even more interesting or important is that the uptake correlates with the score of the disease, so with the severity of the disease in these animal models. And also not shown here, obviously, is when we don't use the sulfate, we don't see the compounds in the joints, just the hydroxy compound. And we also included here an antibody, just an IgG antibody with no interaction in this model. There's also no uptake, but I haven't shown this here. Something like imaging then in the range of 800 nanometers of irradiation. As I said earlier, this is a smaller compound here. This ETA has a molecular weight of 80,000 Dalton, and we inject something like in the range of 10 nanomoles per animal. So this was interesting to see, and then we went on to the other anions, anions, like also phosphates and bisphosphonates. And we found that in comparison to the sulfate here, even a compound, but with a much lesser degree of modification, is even all very similarly taken up into joints with inflammation. So a so-called DPG BP 7%, so 7% of the hydroxy groups were transferred into a bisphosphonate. And you we know that these are compounds which have affinity to hydroxyapatite, to bone tissue. We find also here accumulation in the bone and also uptake in cartilage, but only at higher clinical score. So this looks similar. This compound, the sulfate, goes into the joints much faster. But here we end up with score-dependent contrasts at 24 hours. And when we look now into tissue slices afterwards, we see that the bone marrow takes the compound here, the bisphosphonate, and just when everything is destroyed and you cannot really distinguish between the cartilage and the surfaces, and bone marrow, there's also uptake in cartilage. But this is something we expect, that phosphonates are going to the bone. We were interested in to see how can we direct these compounds with respect to diseases, distinguishing between something which destroys cartilage, like in rheumatoid arthritis, and something which is happening in the bone tissue, like osteoarthritis. So then there was a project then, the PhD student, Sabine Reimann, took the native cartilage and incubated this with all these several polyanions, anions, which we synthesized. And we saw, interestingly, a highest uptake with a so-called mixed compound where we put on the surface of this polyglycerol sulfate, something in a rate of 60%, and this 7% bisphosphonate. What you see here is are different anions, and this is here a tremendously high uptake in cartilage, and which is even boosted when there is a trigger for inflammation put into this tissue, IL, interleukin 1 beta, which triggers an inflammation response. And with that, the uptake with time was even much more higher. And this tells us that the sulfate is something which might go rather into inflammatory tissues, whereas the phosphonate, everything which is, has to do with phosphor, goes into the bone tissue itself. And this is interesting to direct these compounds. So this looks in terms of, again, some chemistry. What we did is here to take the polyglycerol. This has certain azide groups. We can previously transform hydroxy groups via methylation, acidation into an azide. And what you can do then is to sulfate a high number of hydroxy groups. And then you have this moiety, a bisphosphonate, which we can then do with click chemistry, put onto this surface again. And last but not least, also put a fluorescent dye, this Cy3 type dye, ICC, we call it, into this compound and have this red fluorescence here in the tissues. So it's ongoing work. It's interesting that the different types of anions act differently. Indeed, that DPGS, so the sulfate again, is taken up into articular chondrocytes and synovial fibroblasts. There's a tremendous uptake into these cells of this compound. By the way, and this would trigger or raises the question, a very stable compound, polyether, we don't know is it degradable or not. We have to deal with the question, cellular uptake means deposition there. Does this compound get out? And what's happening then with organs, with cells, where we don't want to have this compound? Coming to this just in a minute. So what we can say here is then finally that polyanion composition, it might be useful for directional targeting in joint disease, where sulfur-based anions go rather to something which is related to inflammation and cartilage decomposition, whereas phosphor-based compounds go rather to something related to the bone tissue. And interesting then to combine these anions. We synthesize currently also compounds where these where the anions are spatially separated. So on the one hand, an arm of dendrimer with sulfate, on the other hand with phosphonate or bisphosphonate. And maybe this is something which is able to accumulate just in the connection between these two tissues, where also these diseases occur and where it's important to treat them. Okay, but so let's come to the second more critical part of the project or of these compounds. We have done quite a number of also therapeutic studies, which are summarized here. I won't go into detail with the results on that. Maybe rather something like this, where we saw that that the compound works in the decrease of reperfusion ischemia in a stroke model, for instance, in a brain of an animal, where we can, if we give the compound and induce a stroke, the onset of inflammation in the brain is put down to a minimal lower value, so we have a strong reduction of infarct area, which is very important in stroke, and many other things like collagen-induced rheumatoid arthritis itself, contact dermatitis, and so on and so forth. Not a time now to go into detail with that. This is ongoing work, but I would like to show something else, which we did in collaboration with. As published here with a group or in Dresden-Rossendorf, where they have the capability to work with radioactivity and do radioactive organ distribution. So what we did is we took the core polyglycerol, so the neutral non-sulfated compound, and then the sulfated compound, both of which labeled with a chelator for gallium-86. This is a PET isotope, which you can nicely use for biodistribution studies. And get values for all the organs here. Yeah? So for the non-sulfated compounds, and we have different molecular weights of this core, you see then a certain organ distribution, where is the compound going. And what you see is also a certain liver uptake. What you see, the larger the compound gets, the more it's going to be a particle. So you have a higher liver uptake, probably the usual way of getting the compound then excreted into hepatocytes. But more interesting or more alarming, actually, is when we sulfate the compounds, 10 kilodalton, 20 kilodalton, almost 300 kilodalton, as a result of the sulfation of these compounds, you actually boost the liver uptake. Yeah? What you see here is that even the smaller compounds already then are taken up by the liver. And this is something we found out. There's a tremendous uptake into hepatocytes, into liver tissue, which is critical with respect to the pharmacokinetics of the compound. You don't give the compound time to go into other tissues, because the first, second pass, liver is taking the compound out of circulation. So this is something we have to keep in mind with this effect here, especially because a polyglycerol, at least the version we have been synthesizing so far, is apparently not degradable. We have a polyether. We don't have ester, amides, stuff like that. And you would ask yourself, how would cytochrome P oxidase, how would they manage to decompose the compound and get it excreted? Yeah, that's something we have to ask ourselves. Current work is ongoing on this. So the sulfation triggers strong uptake into cells, also hepatocytes, even for smaller sizes. Hep2 cells, yeah, we have an uptake, and other tumor type cells. And what you can see here is that, interestingly, even the small compounds, yeah, are taken up after sulfation above a certain value, as here, with a core size. That means this is nothing which has to do with particle structure and endocytosis based on the mechanisms we know for particles, something which is based on the sulfate. And so that might lead to unfavorable PK in animals due to liver uptake. And we are currently working on new design approaches towards degradable polymers. Regardless of that, we would need to have them degraded and really consider long-term storage things, which are actually today also discussed for polyethylene glycol, as you may have heard, that PEG, polyethylene glycol, is the major polymer for protein modification today. Is identified to be stored in end capillaries and also to induce, even although this is a polymer, certain immune response. There are antibodies which are identified direct, which are formed against polyethylene glycol. Something like this, all these things have to be considered. So what we do is now to take this polyether dendrimer and to introduce, on the one hand, shell degradable polyanions like ester groups in the system, and this is the work already published by Sabine Reimann, to be able to degrade this compound a little bit, yeah, to get rid of the sulfate groups on the one hand, but still we might be able to degrade everything. And this is on projects which are ongoing right now, to introduce also esters, to copolymerize with esters, with carboxylic acids to form esters, or also to introduce disulfide bridges. We would like to have the compounds, everybody of us likes to have the compounds, we have seen this 2 days ago, in the cytosol of cells, not necessarily in endosomes. The oncogenes, the interesting targets, are located in the cytosol, like P53 and so on, where we would like to have compounds going, and maybe also the carrier molecules going, transporting compounds. So something which can be degraded under reductively under reductive conditions is interesting, but also then using completely other esters here, like the Bolton polyester backbone, also already known, maybe better degradable, and so on and so forth. And yeah, and with that I can actually stop and thank the large group here, So Professor Haag, who was originally invited here, I'm actually doing the job for him here because he wasn't able to make it. And my subgroup, some were hidden here, or even here already jumping into the sea. So all the entire group jumped into the sea afterwards, and none of them were degradable. They all returned completely. But this is good in this case. Yeah. So thanks a lot for your attention.
So we have time for a few questions.
Based on nanoparticles but not dendrimers that you can compare your result with and say that this is really sulfonate-based event?
You mean other structures which are not these?
It doesn't have to be the polyether dendrimer, I'm guessing.
Sure.
Just phosphonates, because if you coat nanoparticles with phosphonates, then we know that they will end up in the bone.
Right.
So with the sulfonate, you know, is there a special selectivity for the inflammation? If we sulfonate a nanoparticle, do we expect it to end up in the inflammation as well?
We have different other structures, also like gold particles with the surface. They have all the same properties, but the sulfate triggers this one. And now going also to certain nanogels, where we include like dendron structures to have a certain sulfate degree. This all goes into inflammation. It's quite, let's say, universal. Yeah, it's happening. Once there's an assembly of sulfate, you can have inflammation direction. Yeah.
Another question? Maybe I will ask one. I think that the key point in your compound is the non-degradability of these compounds. And so the problem of the poly esters is that generally they degrade very rapidly, so you have one part which is non-degradable and the other which is highly degradable. Yeah. So have to manage this.
Certainly, yeah, we have to manage this. And but we saw with one compound, with a polyester and then a sulfate, this seems we expected that the degradation would be even faster. Even that one was not degradable. We assume that there's really a protein corona. This all thing is protected against enzymes, against even hydrolysis. Yeah, and this is something we have to trigger and to play with, yeah, to introduce just the number of degradable groups which can be degraded. We think also about acetals and ketals, which might be even more acid sensitive, but might be protected in the circulation, but then at the end of the day, the liver or the excretory organs have to do the job. And at that point, we have to avoid that all these particles, everybody has to avoid this, all this research seen here, end up there and nobody knows where they are going, or where they're ending up.
No more. Thank you very much.